So this is the question, and we are hoping to develop our idea all the way up to the idea of center of gravity. Okay. So now, what we had stated yesterday was that how is this happening? What is supporting the stone on this side, on the other side? We can't use the weight argument because we understand that it is the torques that are being balanced, not the weights, which means it is the force of gravity multiplied by the perpendicular distance from the line of action of force to the axis of rotation. The axis of rotation, of course, being here. This is where it will rotate through. Now, how do we understand this? Well, there is a force on this side. We can see the force, mg, but we can't see the force on the other side. So then there is a suggestion from some people that there is a force that is acting on this side, and that force is actually the weight of the scale. So the mass of the scale times the gravitational constant. Okay, and this is the mass of the stone times the gravitational constant. So then the obvious question arises, why at that point, why at the center do you show the mass of the scale acting from? Isn't the mass distributed everywhere? I've just drawn it a little off center. I realized when I looked at the screen, just shift it a little bit. Okay. Does that look like it's closer to the center? Hopefully it does. Okay. So, but then why place the mass as acting from that point? Why not from any other point? Because the mass elements are distributed everywhere, right? So to understand that, we have to think a little bit, okay? We can ask the question, when we balance the scale, so this was the first exercise that we did, right, in terms of thinking about it. When we balance the scale like this through the center of the scale, that was at that 50 centimeter mark, approximately 50 centimeter mark, because the variation is because of the manufacturing of the scale, the density of the wood, etc. But in an ideal scale, let's say, you dangled it from the 50 centimeter mark. Now, in this case, you do it in such a way that the anti-clockwise moments and the clockwise moments, right, I'm abbreviating it to clockwise moments, anti-clockwise moments, right, they are balanced. Okay. Then what happens to the mass of the scale? Why are they balanced? So you can then say that, well, the mass of the scale times the g is acting downwards in this side, and there is a tension in the string which provides the support force, right? So these two forces cancel each other out, and therefore there is no acceleration in this direction, in the y direction, and since there is no torque now on either side, therefore there is a balance in the system. Okay, so you say that there is static equilibrium, sigma f is equal to zero. Okay, let's start from that position. You can also achieve exactly the same thing if you were to balance the scale, right? If you were to balance the scale also on its center point, you have to try and do this. Okay, so I'm balancing the scale. There is a little bit of torque that is being generated this way and that way, and that's because of the overhead fan, the ceiling fan. The wind is causing it to. But if I ask you the question, will I be able to balance the scale if I hold it at that point? Right? It's not possible. So if I go anywhere off that center point, right, either this way or this way, then I end up creating some kind of a torque, either a clockwise or an anti-clockwise, right? So if I move somewhere over here, just off it, no way. I hope you're able to see that. It is touching the whiteboard on that side, but it's off the ground on this side. Right? So the question then comes is, what is this center of mass exactly? Okay, can we come to a definition of this point? That point exactly from where, if I suspend an object, right, it balances. Okay, so in fact, you can even imagine it as if I did it like this. Oops. A seesaw kind of an example. Right, there is a point at which I can balance this object in such a way, right, that there is no torque left this way or this way, and that point over there, right, has to be supporting the entire weight of the object. Do you see that also? So how will you define this point? That point happens to be called the center of gravity. But how will you define it? Is there a good way to specify exactly what that is? So for a definition to be complete, it has to be unique, right? Which means that it has to describe only the thing, exclusively the thing that you are trying to describe. So it has to be unique, but at the same time, it should also be sufficient, which means that it should describe it completely. Okay, there should be no ambiguity left in the statement. So for example, I'm sorry, I'm going to take Aryan's example, because it's such a good one to show what a definition is not. I know that you are just developing a concept. In the development, it doesn't matter. So the average point of all mass in the object, that shows a stage in your thinking which you have to develop forward in order to get a definition for this concept, the center of gravity, which has to be both unique and sufficient. Okay, set, shoot.
So I was saying, like, outside of which, my statement was, it is the point outside of which there is equal distribution of mass.
There is equal distribution of mass outside of which, or you could say around which.
Yeah, around which. More correct.
Around which there is an equal distribution of mass. Okay. All right, so let's examine that statement in a bit. Akshay is saying something. It is the point where the mass of the object is equal to the gravity. Point where the mass of an object is equal to that of gravity. Well, no, Akshay, not quite, because there will be no point on an object, right, whose mass is going to be equal to that of gravity. In fact, it can't be even said as mass, because mass is a measure of the amount of matter, and gravity is actually a force. So you can't compare mass and a force. Okay, so you have to develop that. But even if you say that it is the point where the weight of the object is equal to that of gravity, even that would not be a sufficient definition for this. It's not unique enough. Think about it. So yeah, Nandan, Aryan and Seth are kind of pointing to the same thing, a point where the weight of an object is evenly distributed on both sides. Yeah, that's like kind of pretty close to what the definition of the center of mass is, except that I'm going to take you through a quick run through the rigorous definition of what is center of mass or center of gravity, sorry. You will have to think a little bit about it. So what we can say is that, going back to what Akshay said, is that the center of mass is a point on an object where if you provide a support force, right, to the weight of the object will have zero torque. Okay, so I'm kind of combining the two things, what Akshay is saying and what others are saying. And I'm saying that point, the center of gravity, is a point on the object. Well, actually, that center of gravity, I'll demonstrate a little bit later, need not even be a point on the object. Okay, so you can say that it is a point in space through which, if you provide support force, there is zero torque around that support point. Okay, it's a little bit an unwieldy definition, but I'm trying to combine what different people have said and make something out of it. Okay, and the argument, let me just finish this point, and the argument for why there is zero torque when you support the center of gravity, that I will demonstrate, or I will talk about briefly after what Seth has to say. Yeah, Seth, go ahead.
So to sum it up, you're saying the point,
yeah,
where applying a support force equal to gravity.
Applying a support force, that's all. Equal to gravity. Yes, you are right. Correct. Go ahead. Equal to the weight of the object, you should say. Applying a support force equal to the weight of the object. Or you can say that applying an adequate support force.
If I apply an adequate support force on that point,
yeah,
there will be no other torque left.
There will be no torque left. Correct. Okay. And the argument for that is something like this. Why will there be no torque left? Is that you can take an object, maybe even an irregular object to begin with. Okay. And you say that this irregular object is made up of many, many mass elements. So people from the Blitzkrieg will remember this. Did I do this in the Blitzkrieg? Okay, so I have taken some example mass elements in this. In fact, I'll get rid of the M6. So M1, M2, these are all infinitesimally small mass elements. We didn't do it, okay. So very, very tiny. This is a three-dimensional object. And all these points are infinitesimally small mass elements. Okay, that means they are very, very, very tiny. Not insignificantly small, not compared to the mass of an electron. But let's say compared to the mass of a collection of protons and neutrons. Okay, so infinitesimally mass elements. And then we say, okay, where will the center of the mass for these elements be? By talking about it like this. I take an arbitrary point over here. Okay, and I say that is the center of mass. This arbitrary point, I'm just going to put a legend over here. This X means center of gravity. Sorry, I keep interchangeably saying center of mass and center of gravity. I mean center of gravity because that's what is mentioned in the textbook. Now, let's say that if I provide a support force around that point, okay, from the bottom, let's say, will I be able to support the object without it toppling?
Uh,
No, I won't be, right? And that's pretty obvious, because if I try to support this, most of the mass, assuming of course that these mass elements are uniform in their density. So an object with uniform density. If I support it over here, then there is going to be a sufficient clockwise torque to collapse it. Ah, yes, Janu remembers. We have done it. In which direction should I move the center of gravity? Left or right? Okay. In order to get closer to that point where I can actually then balance it. Yes, exactly, right? It's obvious that I have to move this to the right. So I move this to the right. I say that I come to a point, say here, okay, where it looks like I'm going to get to a point. Why? Because there is greater mass distribution here on this side in comparison to this side. Okay, remember, it's a three-dimensional object. Okay, and the same can be said also if I have the point lower. Okay, if I have the point lower over here also, there is going to be more mass distribution on this side, so there's going to be rotation. So I move the point in such a way that now there is zero torque. Okay, but how does the zero torque get achieved? The zero torque gets achieved by, oops, drop the marker. Okay, by, I'm just going to relabel these. This was M1, this was M2, okay. How I'm going to do that? I'm going to take two or three bits over here. And you say this mass element M1 has a weight, M1G. This mass element also has a weight, M2G. This mass element has a weight, M4G, M3G, M5G. Correct? And each one of these mass elements is going to exert a torque on that center of gravity. How do we know that? Well, you look at the line of action of the force. This is the line of action of the force, right? And then there is a distance between this point and the line of action of a force. So the force of that weight of M1 times this distance plus the force of the weight of M2 times this distance are causing the clockwise moment. And then the force of the weight of M4 times that distance is causing anti-clockwise moment. M3 is causing anti-clockwise moment. M5 is causing anti-clockwise moment, right? So what you will find is now all the clockwise moments and all the anti-clockwise moments tend to resolve to zero only if you take that axis, that center of gravity as the point. If you go anywhere else off that center of gravity, there's either going to be more torque from this side or more torque from this side. Therefore, it will start causing some kind of a rotational motion. All right. So does this explain uniquely and sufficiently what the center of gravity is? Now, Manya, you have to say something a little more sharply. What exactly did you not get? Yeah. So then what we are trying to do is we are trying to understand this concept of, I'm just going to sum it up as Anusha is saying. Yes, that point set, the point will be infinitesimally small. In fact, it's imaginable. It has zero dimensions. So Anusha is saying, sum it up. So we are saying what I'm trying to get to is, what is this point center of gravity? For a very simple understanding of center of gravity, it is just the point from where if you provide a support, there will be zero torque, like in the case of this scale that I was trying to balance, right? So if I provide a support force to the center of gravity, the object is going to balance evenly. If I move my hand anywhere beyond that point, the support force provided is insufficient, it's going to cause a torque. So it will rotate this way or that way, depending upon where it is. I'll come to that, Akshay. So then we attempt to define it in such a way that we said that the center of gravity is a point, an imaginary dimensionless point, at which, to which if you provide sufficient support force, there would be no torque or moment of force about that point, which means it will be completely balanced. Okay. To answer the question, why does it balance about that point? I gave a slightly rigorous definition, which involves a three-dimensional object. See, if I give you a simple two-dimensional object, it's also very easy to understand. Okay, so if I take a simple object like that, imagine this as a three-dimensional object, right, which has a center of gravity. You can see that it will be even exactly in the center, provided that it has uniform density and so on. Now I know that I have to provide the support force right below it in order to balance it. Why does it balance? Well, take, for the sake of simplicity, just two pieces of mass, M1, M2. Okay, infinitesimally small mass particles that exert a torque. How does a mass particle exert a torque? Well, the mass particle has a gravitational pull. Right, I can say it's M1g. This one has a pull, M2g. Now you may have billions of such mass particles, right? But I am taking it for two points. This exerts a torque, right, in this direction, which will be M1g multiplied by this distance d. That's what a torque is. M2g does exactly the same, except it will be M2 times G multiplied by this distance, D2. Let's keep as D1 and D2. Right. Now, obviously, the center of gravity is such a point where all the mass elements which are pulling it in the clockwise direction multiplied by their perpendicular distances to the center of gravity, line of action of force, etc., etc., will be exactly equal to the anti-clockwise moments created by the mass elements on the other side. So the center of gravity is that point where everywhere around it, the mass is distributed evenly. But what do I mean by evenly? It's not about the mass, it's about the torque. The torque has to be evenly distributed. So from uniform objects, you can use the same definition for non-uniform objects too. And it means exactly the same. Okay. So do please look at this. It's a very interesting development of a concept of center of gravity. And if you get this idea of what a center of gravity is, you know, you are quite a way home. Ratul says, can you please define moment exactly? Moment of a force is the torque created by that force about an axis of rotation. Okay. Two classes back. You can always go back and look at the video. Okay. So we have a way in which we understand what is a moment of a force. And now we can come back to this situation and say, well, right. So the mass of the stone multiplied by this distance of the stone from the axis of rotation must be equal to the mass of the scale, of course the weight of the scale, so the mass multiplied by the g, multiplied by the distance of the cg, center of gravity, to the axis of rotation. And therefore, while it seems invisible, that there seems to be no weight on this side, which is countering the weight on this side, it is the weight of the scale itself which is being countered on this side. And therefore, the entire system is in equilibrium. Okay. In other words, what has happened is that the mass of center of gravity of the scale has got shifted over here because of the addition of the stone. So the center of gravity of the entire system, including the stone now, lies over here. That is why you are able to balance it over there. So all the torques from this side and all the torques from that side get cancelled to zero. Okay. So what we have discussed is a fairly, you know, cognitively heavy concept and idea, and you need to sit down and think through this carefully to be able to grasp something meaningful from this. And of course, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So you would have to actually solve some problems, answer some questions, and then you know whether you have got it or not. We will come to that by and by. So I have sent you people an invitation today to join a Google Classroom. It's something that I have just created. I mean, Permal sir has been using it for his maths classes, I'm sure. So for me, it's new. Maybe it's not new for you. And in that Google form, I have created, Google Classroom, I have created a Google form with 6 questions on concepts up to but not including center of gravity. So do please answer those questions. It's free form questions. And then there are a few multiple choice questions. And submit those forms. I will get back to you with the results about that. The assignment is due tomorrow. So the sooner you can get it completed, the better. I repeat, we are not meeting tomorrow because I have this other meeting. So therefore, we will meet again on Friday. And on Friday, we will take it. Seth's asking, should he destroy my classical approach? Well, you can't destroy something that has already been destroyed. So it is what it is. For all intents and purposes, classical mechanics works. Manya explained the last part of the scale problem. I'll post the video. You have a look because another class is about to begin. So I have to stop right now. Okay. All right then. See you all on Friday. Do please fill in the Google form and send it back to me. If something is not working, send an email back. Yeah, quickly, 20 seconds left.
What about those modern physics classes?
I'll send another form for that. Okay?
Okay, sir. Today. Thank you.
All right then. Bye.
Sir.